Good evening. I'm Jay Kaplan, pinch hitting for my pal Nisa Petrilli.
I'm Steve Ferguson.
And I'm Anthony Schwing.
And this is the On the Sports Lines 2018 NBA Draft Special. With the NBA Finals in the books, the last piece of business on the association's calendar is the 2018 draft. We'll look at who the Phoenix Suns picked at number one overall, who the Kings, Hawks, and Grizzlies took at 2, 3, and 4. We'll give you a little bit of a hint, there was a trade involved. And we'll look at who the Knicks chose at number 9. We'll also give you 3 teams we think LeBron James should consider going to this summer, and 3 things that have jumped out at us so far in group play of the 2018 World Cup. As always, you can follow us on social media, follow us on Twitter at On the Sports Lines, and find us on Facebook and like us there at facebook.com/onthesportslines. All right, the 2018 NBA draft is happening as we come to you tonight. The first round is midway through, almost to the end. The Phoenix Suns won the draft lottery and the rights to take the number one pick overall, which they used on DeAndre Ayton, the center out of Arizona, right down the block from them. We're going to weigh in on whether we think this was the right pick or the wrong pick. We'll be playing that 3 times tonight. This is round 1. Stephen D.
Yes.
Right pick, wrong pick for Phoenix taking Ayton.
Absolutely the right pick. Phoenix's defense was 30th in the league last year. This guy will come in, shot block, rebound, play defense. Average 20.6 points a game for Arizona. You couldn't have made a better pick, Arizona.
You know, I kind of have to agree. You know, look, he made no secret of the fact that he wanted to go from Tucson to Phoenix to play for the Suns. He grew up, spent most of high school playing basketball in Arizona. So here's my thought on this, is that they have Booker. They're kind of locked in at the backcourt. They have Josh Jackson. They're locked in at small forward. So you've got the perimeter pretty much taken up. You need a guy who's mobile, athletic, can score out of the post, which he can do.
Yes, he can.
He's really good off the left block. He's mobile enough to make moves with either hand. He's underrated skill is his ability to pass out of the post. So I think he will give them that, especially if you look at who they've had on their rosters. Alex Len, you know, Dragan Bender, neither one of these guys has worked out. Tyson Chandler's, you know, pushing up on age.
Yep.
So you get a guy who's got a good combination of size and athleticism, gives him in the post. He's developing as a mid-range shooter. And honestly, if you want to, like, take the stretch, if he turns into even, like, a smaller version in terms of skill set of Joel Embiid, this is going to work out for, like, years to come.
Definitely.
You know what? I'm going to make it a trifecta.
Consensus.
The 3 of us.
yeah.
That's a great pick. You had to go with Ayton. I mean, I'm going with you as well. You have Devin Booker, and that 1-2 combination is going to be really good for the next few years.
Yeah, absolutely.
But also, we look at his size. Great specimen. He's going into a situation where you have Tyson Chandler, who's going to be able to mentor him and let him grow as a big man in the NBA, which is going to be very important. He has a great mid-range shot, and when today's NBA has a big, you have to shoot. The days of a big man just taking up
camping
space,
out, yeah,
it's gone. Yeah. It's stink at this point. Mm-hmm. But he's a good pass out of the double teams, so that's pretty good at 2.5 court. What's going to be the thing is how quickly can he develop on the defensive end, because the Suns were the worst defensive team in the NBA by leaps and bounds.
Yeah.
And if they're going to get any better, he has to learn how to be a good rim protector and a decent shot blocker. But, I mean, he's very coachable, too. So, there's so much upside. He's going right down the road. He made no secret. He wanted to be Phoenix Suns.
Yes, he did.
It's a great pick. It's the only pick right now.
Yeah.
Charles Barkley basically said, don't mess this up. I'm cleaning up my language.
Well, because it's Charles, we know he didn't do it cleanly.
Because it's Charles, we know. Hey, look, it's PG. We got to keep this PG-13, ladies and gentlemen. But the Suns just made the obvious choice, and I got to agree with you two.
Yeah, I don't think you can do any way. All right, moving on, gentlemen. The Kings, the Hawks, and the Grizzlies picked at 2, 3, and 4. Each of us is going to take one of these teams. and give you our thoughts as we play another round of Right Pick, Wrong Pick. Anthony's going to lead us off. He's got the Kings at number two. They wound up taking Marvin Bagley III, center out of Duke. Right pick, wrong pick.
You know what? I'm going to go with the wrong pick because I'm looking at Luka Doncic, who I think would have been a tremendous fit for the Sacramento Kings team that could not score in the half-court offense. You need a guy who can create his own shot. He's one of the best pick-and-roll players in the draft. He's a versatile scorer. He can stretch the court. You put him in the backcourt with De'Aaron Fox, who is also a guy who I really think got a great upside.
Mm-hmm.
The Kings need to play more up-tempo basketball. That's something that they may not be able to do with Bagley Jr. Not that I can't suppose he's a great scorer, has a great upside, but it tells you a lot about what the Kings think of Willie Cauley-Stein, the draft from a few years ago, and his development not coming along the way they thought.
Yep.
I really thought Doncic would have been a much better fit in Sacramento and them playing up-tempo. Vlade Divac was very high on him.
So I don't know who...
overruled him. There's too many voices in that front office right
there
now.
There may be.
So you had Atlanta right after me, and they're definitely busy tonight. They made a pick and they made a trade. So I need to know, what do you think?
You know, they originally drafted Luka Doncic out of Real Madrid, who a lot of people felt was an NBA-ready player. I'm not as high on him. And then they turned around and struck a deal with the Dallas Mavericks at number five to essentially swap picks because the Mavs took Trae Young, point guard out of Oklahoma, and the two teams swapped picks. Look, to me, the Hawks are in a full-on rebuild mode, so best player available would have been the way to go. I don't know if Trae Young would be my pick as best player available. I would have, Bagley if he was available. Jaren Jackson, the power forward big man out of Michigan State, would have been my choice because they needed front court scoring. They needed front court help, period. Despite the fact that they've got two young guys already under contract in Terran Price and John Collins. But I do understand the pick. Schroeder? How do you pronounce it, Steve? You told me before.
Schroeder.
There you go.
Yeah.
Dennis may not be the answer at point guard for these guys. So the concern here is that they were looking to draft, who could be his replacement. Here's the thing with Trey. He needs to bulk up. And he is about as weak a defensive player, backcourt player coming into the NBA next year as I have seen. Oklahoma had to hide him in their defensive schemes. Part of it was to keep him from wearing down. The guy had a 38.5% usage rate last season. Look, he has a unique ability to create his own shot, offense off the bounce, which obviously you need as a point guard in this league. He can pull up from NBA range. He can break people down. He's good at coming off ball screens. He reads the hedge really well. And he can finish at the rim, layups, floaters. He's got a nice arsenal, but he can't go too crazy with the shot selection. He would rain bombs from all over the place, kind of how Steph Curry used to when he was at Davidson.
Exactly.
So you got to rein that in. Steph Cat did. Hopefully he will too. Look, needs to bulk up. And honestly, they got to figure out a way to get this kid to play defense. I mean, in his pro day, he was guarding the freaking equipment manager.
Yikes.
You know, so that's where it's at. I don't agree with the pick, but I understand it. So, with that being said, Steve, the Grizzlies took Jaren Jackson, forward out of Michigan State. Right pick, wrong pick?
I would have to hesitate and say wrong pick. Now, I like Trae Young, and here's the thing. Trae Young, in addition to being a great scorer, is also one asset he has that you didn't mention is he's a great assist guy. And the reason I thought he'd be a great pick is you have to look at Mike Conley, and remember last year he was injured most of last season. Mm-hmm. This guy, to me, could have at the very least, been Mike Conley's backup, and he would have learned from Mike Conley probably how to play better defense. You would assume he'd bulk up and get more physical and stronger. But I think his shooting ability, maybe if he can rein it in a little bit, he could be potentially almost as good as what Steph Curry is when you see how well he shoots from the outside.
Yeah, you know what? And honestly, since he wasn't available, if they wanted a point guard that badly, I would have gone with Colin Sexton. But that's just me, the guy out of Alabama.
That's a very good pick, too.
We're going to wrap up our actual draft pick coverage tonight by looking at the hometown New York Knicks. They're coming off a 23-59 season. They got that, which got them the ninth overall pick. They took, and this surprised all three of us as we were watching the draft before coming on the air tonight, Kevin Knox, the forward out of Kentucky. Final round of right pick, wrong pick as we debate the choice of the newest Knick. Anthony, start us off. They needed help everywhere, the Knicks did.
Amen.
So was this the right pick or the wrong pick, considering who was still on the board?
As much as I would have preferred Michael Porter Jr., this is actually a really good pick for the Knicks.
Okay.
They need help everywhere, particularly in the wing. You look at the Knicks roster, you had Tim Hardaway Jr. playing out of position and an underwhelming 17 a game. He was getting bullied around. Courtney Lee, Michael Beasley, these guys playing out of position at power forward, small forward position, respectively, not a good look. With Kevin Knox, he comes in, 7-foot wingspan. He needs to develop a defensive end. That's something the Knicks definitely need him to do. But a great upside, explosive player. He's going to be a really good scorer, great two-way player. I know Porter was more of the offensive player, without question. That's somebody I would have picked. But his back injury, and with the Knicks,
without
Porzingis for much of next season, if not all of next season, you just couldn't risk this pick and Porter Jr. and he not being healthy. So Kevin Knox, I think it's a great pick. I don't know what the heck the Knicks fans are thinking in the Boston Center and booing. That could be a good sign.
Well, sure,
they booed Porzingis, and it's not really well,
yes,
by the way.
Sean called
by
that.
Yes, he did. The same kid and his family who booed Porzingis was in attendance tonight.
Oh, really?
And they was not approval of Kevin Knox. So maybe that's a good sign if you're a Knicks fan.
But other than that,
I think it's a great pick for the Knicks.
See, here's the thing. I agree with the position in terms of the pick because, to me, what the Knicks needed most was wing length defense and shooting from the perimeter. But, I would have gone with a guy who was only about 200 miles down the road at Villanova, and that would have been Michael Bridges from the Wildcats. The way I look at it is this. This is a guy who... 17 points, 5 boards, grabbed almost a couple of steals a game. He's 6'7", but he has a 7-plus wingspan. Great defensive instincts. Good. He can guard anybody on the perimeter, can shot block around the rim, average more than a block and a steal. He's a good on-ball defender. He shot 43.5% from downtown, so he gives the Knicks a guy who maybe not is a catch-and-shoot guy, but is a spot-up shooter off drive and kick or off ball movement. Look, granted he can't create his own shot at the moment, but that may be evolve. And he's more fluid than athletic, so, you know, it glides around as opposed to quick first step. But I look at this. Length, defensive prowess. He'll be able to guard people from the outset, which to me, if you can guard in the NBA, there's going to be a place for you on somebody's roster. But I think his ability to be solid in all facets of the game and better in others, to me, I would have gone with him as the pick more than Knox. Stephen Day, your thoughts?
You know, I guess the more you talk about Kevin Knox, the more I'm being somewhat convinced this may be the right pick. But the guy that I would have gone with, and I know you guys are going to kill me for saying it because you know how much I like UCLA, Aaron Holiday.
Okay.
Because I think Aaron Holiday would have done two things for the Knicks. He's a guy who not only plays very good defense, he also scores. And I think with Ntilikina, that's the one thing Ntilikina can't do is score. So if you put a guy on like this who plays both sides of the court, he averaged 20.2 a game, 15.3 rebounds. He was UCLA's leader without question. I think he would have brought a certain level of leadership that the Knicks really need. And he's a young guy. Kevin Knox is 18 years old. He's got a great upside. From what I'm hearing, he might be a very good pick. But I think that Aaron Holiday was a little bit more NBA ready for a team like the Knicks.
He may very well be, and you know, he's got the DNA. I think the only reason they didn't go that route, even though he was on the board, is because a lot of people don't see him as a top 10 pick.
Yeah.
They don't see him as a starter. They see him as a rotation guy, and rotation guys don't get picked top 10. They get picked 15 to 20. But overall, I agree with you. All right, so... Now that we've tied up all the draft picks, we're going to move on to the NBA offseason, which officially starts July 1 as the calendar flips. And the biggest story of the offseason will LeBron leave his hometown Cleveland Cavaliers again? The prevailing opinion is that King James will opt out of his deal July 1 and be looking to play elsewhere next season. We're going to look at three places we think he should go. Steve, you kind of gave us a hint with your closing on your last show. Where do you see him? I know where you're going to, where you say he should go. Tell me why he should go there and how they can make it happen.
First of all, and for those of you who didn't see the show last time we did it.
Shame on you.
Yeah, exactly. I have him going to the Houston Rockets. I mean, I look at this trio as being as good as what the Golden State Warriors put on the table. You can have a guy like LeBron James with Chris Paul, two of the best playmakers on the planet, and you have James Harden, who is without question one of the best outside shooters. You add that to the roster they had. They were sixth in the league on defense, playing with the 7-second offense that D'Antoni loves to play. And I really see that as a great winning combo. The problem is, in getting LeBron, you'd have to do a lot of things differently. Yeah. First of all, you would be forced to trade Ryan Anderson. And although there are teams that say, why should we get him? He was a very valuable player on the Houston Rockets.
It's a tough contract to take on, though.
It is. And the second thing is, with Chris Paul, he'll be getting most likely the max deal, 5 years, $205 million. How do you put LeBron into the mix with that guy? And the third thing is, look, if you get him, you probably have to trade either P.J. Tucker or you have to let Clint Capella go. Mm. And Clint Capella is an emerging star at the center position. So it could be done, but there would have to be a lot of compromises for it to work. But I can tell you right now, I would absolutely love it if he wound up in Houston.
Well, you know, I'm going to stay in the state of Texas. Mm-hmm. I mean, and I have said this off camera to both the rabbi and some other people, that I think the place landing place for LeBron James is San Antonio, and I think that's whether Kawhi leaves or not. Mm. I mean, if you think about it, there's no doubt. Everybody knows the respect that LeBron has for Greg Popovich
that's
when he
true.
Played for him on the U.S. Olympic team. You know, and he may, I don't think that there's much of a secret that Pop would jump at the chance to get LeBron to come play for him, you know, and potentially end the Warriors' stranglehold on the West. You know, here's the thing. If James is thinking about prolonging his career, and he's, you know, a lot of usage in the last two, 3 years.
Yes.
Nobody knows how to manage and massage resting their stars and keeping them fresh than Popovich and the Spurs, right?
Good point.
So, you know, this is, and here's the thing. Look, they're going to have to free up some cap space no matter what they do. You know, to sign him outright, they're going to have to say goodbye to the likes of, you know, Tony Parker, Danny Green, Rudy Gay. These guys are either going to have to opt out or they're going to have to make sure player options don't get picked up.
Wow.
You know, you may have to trade Paul Gasol to a team, possibly the Cavs, in order to make that work. And here, you know, if they can have LeBron opt in and facilitate a trade with Cleveland, that's the easy way to do it. That may force, you know, the Spurs to include LaMarcus Aldridge in that type of package, but I'm guessing if they get Kevin Love back, that's a wash. And look, and here's the thing, if they trade Kawhi, that's pretty much a salary swap right there. And
yeah.
Here's the thing. The other flip side of that is that if LeBron comes there, it might convince Kawhi to stay, even though it seems like he's got one foot out the door. Mm-hmm. You know, Popovich is still working at trying to get him to stick around. Maybe he gets the 5-year extension, trying to entice him to stay. And I don't, if I'm Kawhi and I get like a behind the back channel phone call from LeBron saying, hey, dude, you stick around, I'm coming. You know, you might as well stay put. Look, if they make this work, they're going to have to give up a lot, okay? And it's the same thing they kind of had to do. They had to move a lot of people around, move mountains, move dollars, like when they signed Aldridge in 2015. But here's the thing. If they even think they have a shot, they should go for it, because I think it would be a great fit for both LeBron and the Spurs.
Interesting. You know what? I'm going to go the opposite. I think LeBron stays in Cleveland, Ohio.
Anthony!
When he left Cleveland to go to Miami, it was to win a championship. When he went back to Cleveland, it was to live up to that promise of bringing a title to Cleveland. He's done both. Now at 33, he has a family, by the way. And you kind of forget that family does, you know, play a factor in the free agency.
They do.
He may be a little reluctant to uproot his family again. Mm-hmm. But also, you look at the Cavaliers roster. This team made the NBA Finals and play under 40 games. Give them a full season. Who knows what kind of potential they have?
Fair.
You just drafted Colin Sexton, who is a tremendous player, and he's going to help the Cavs in a one weakness, perimeter defense, because they were terrible. They couldn't stop anybody.
Not to mention giving them a better secondary ball handler.
Yes, without question. But also, when you look at the options, too many teams have to get their roster to add LeBron James. The Lakers, the only team that can sign him. By the way, the Lakers, you know what? You're going to have Lakers
here,
fans.
Here it comes. If you haven't followed him on on Facebook, here's what you're missing.
You know what? Lakers fans, I'm going to tell you this. Get on your team and tell them to stop selling the LA lifestyle and start selling basketball, because that's what brings free agents. We don't care about living in LA, okay? We can do that on a vacation. We want to win basketball games. And you're threatening to get rid of your entire young core to bring LeBron in and try to build your own super team. This is the problem I have with the Lakers the last 4 years. Mm. That They're like the Knicks. They have one plan and deviate from it because they are the Lakers. They want to be the star. We bring stars in. Mm-hmm. Nobody cares about Jack Nicholson anymore. I'm sorry. I love Jack.
I like Jack. You can't say that about him. It's my favorite actor.
And if you can't sell winning basketball to a free agent, I don't care about Los Angeles. I could be a star in Milwaukee. We have the Greek Freak for that. And look, I think LeBron stays in Cleveland. He signs a max deal. He gets the most money from Cleveland, $205 million. He retires at Cleveland Cavs. He talked about possibly owning the Cavs. It's going to happen.
Wow. It may happen.
My words.
I let him off the leash and you see what happens. We're going to move from the hardwood to the pitch. On our last show, we did our 2018 World Cup preview, two different segments. Tonight, we're going to talk about what's jumped out for us, three different things that have jumped out for us in group play, which is now well underway. Stephen D., what's been the best individual performance so far in group play? And I kind of know where you're going with this.
Yeah, it's got
it's the obvious one, right?
It's got to be Ronaldo's hat trick.
Yeah, I mean, got to be, right?
This guy has been absolutely phenomenal in the cup. I don't follow soccer that much, but I can tell you those three goals he had were unbelievable. And, I mean, he's the reason if Portugal gets to the finals and wins this thing, he'll be the reason why. The other superstars, Messi, as we all know, missed a huge penalty shot at the end of the game. Neymar really didn't look that good in the game that I saw, and Ronaldo has just been incredible.
Yeah, you know, and as good as that was, Anthony, do you know where I'm going with the best game so far in group play?
Ooh, let me guess. We were talking about it the other day. Mm. Could it be Portugal and Spain?
Yeah! Wow, look at that. Okay. We're going Captain Obvious again here. You know, and I got to tell you, look, Ronaldo's hat trick, obviously the highlight of that game.
Yes.
But, you know, the back and forth from both sides, terrific action. I mean, if you think about the things that happened in the game, Ronaldo's first goal, 3 minutes and 30 seconds in, that is the fastest goal Spain has ever allowed in a World Cup. It was also just the fourth time a penalty has been scored inside the opening 4 minutes of a World Cup game. The six goals is more goals than Portugal and Spain have scored in their last four combined meetings. Four. I mean, if you think about it, you know, Diego Costa, the Spain striker, scored his first two World Cup goals on his first two World Cup shots on goal. How about that? Mm. Here's the other thing. Spain scores three minutes apart in the second half. Costa, you know, to tie things up. And then Spain's up 3-2 to take after, you know, Portugal goes in up 2-1. And, you know, in the 87th minute, Ronaldo caps his 51st hat trick for club and country, which is also the 51st hat trick scored in the history of the World Cup in the 87th minute to tie the game at 3-3. Best game so far.
Yeah.
In my opinion. Anthony!
Definitely.
Biggest surprise so far.
You know, it's the host nation. That's Russia.
Yeah, how about that?
They're the lowest ranked FIBA team going into the tournament, and they've just been so dominant.
Oh, yeah.
5-0, 3-1 in the two group matchups, a plus 7 goal differential. They can lose the last group match, and now they're only in the round of 16. I mean, Kachanov has done a phenomenal job throwing this ragtag team together.
It has been pretty much a ragtag team.
All the pressure being the host country. We know about the politics involved. Mm-hmm. But that aside, they've just been phenomenal. The home crowd feeding off the energy. They've been a fun team to watch. They just playing up-tempo soccer. We don't see that in soccer.
No,
up-tempo.
We don't.
So it's been just a major sight.
You know what? It is that time. 3 minute warning. Anthony, bat lead off.
While much of the sports world is waiting for the summer of LeBron, in the hockey world it could be the summer of Tavares. John Tavares is a free agent and could be the kind of star that alters the NHL landscape. A career Islander who became the face of a story franchise, it is clear that the frustration of the past few seasons will have an impact on whether he stays or goes. Several teams are in the hunt to sign him while the Islanders hope to christen the new arena in 2021 with him as the star. While the Toronto-born Tavares has stated that he would like to play his career with the Isles, the regression of the team on and off the ice leaves his career at a crossroads. Does he stay loyal or seek greener pastures while still in his prime? One of those teams in a hunt is just a 20-minute train ride away. The only fear bigger for Islander fans than losing Tavares is the sight of him wearing a Rangers sweater next season. Now that is an image that will leave Isles fans waking up in a cold sweat should it become a reality.
Dwight Howard, I can't believe you're with the Brooklyn Nets. Well, if this deal doesn't take the cake, nothing else will. Welcome Dwight Howard to the Brooklyn Nets. The 6'11 man-child, perhaps child-man, has joined this miserable, horribly run franchise that gives away draft picks like the Mets give away ball games. Yet once again, the Nets have engaged in this insane exercise, dealing away center Timofey Mozgov, who barely touched the court in 2017, along with two 2018 second round picks, plus a pick in 2022 for Howard. Are you kidding me? The Charlotte Hornets may have hosed them good this time. Howard has been with five teams in his career, and he's been with three teams in the last 3 years. What should that tell you? He's a train wreck no one wants. And by the way, the last time he won any accolades was 2011 when he was Defensive Player of the Year. While he may resemble Charles Atlas in build, he represents what the Nets are in fact, an underachieving team with little talent since their 2002-2003 NBA Finals appearances, leaving their fans wanting so much more.
Under the heading of You Can't Make This Stuff Up, Barry Trotz, who led the Washington Capitals to their first ever Stanley Cup title, has resigned from the team. Why? Money, of course. Trotz, the NHL's fifth winningest all-time coach, entered this season as a lame duck on the last year of his contract, despite having the NHL's best regular season record over the last 2 years. He coached the entire season in limbo, nearly getting fired twice, and likely would have been gone had the Penguins knocked the Caps out of the playoffs again. Winning the Cup triggered a clause that gave him a 2-year extension with an annual salary of a little over $2 million, which was still well below the ranks of the league's highest paid coaches, especially for ones who've won a Cup. Trotz wanted something in the 5-year, $25 million range, which still would have been less than the $6-plus million a year that Cup winners like Toronto's Mike Babcock and Chicago's Joel Quenneville rake in. Caps GM Brian McClellan wouldn't do it. Why? Quote, "You have a coach that's been here 4 years. You do another five, and that's 9 years. There's not many coaches that have that lasting ability. It's a long time, and it's a lot of money to commit to a coach. Hey, Brian, did you forget that Trotz spent 15 years in Nashville, and he took them to the playoffs 7 times? McClellan then went on to say that Trotz, quote, does probably in some people's minds deserve to be paid in the neighborhood of those other Stanley Cup winning coaches, end quote. But then he added, he doesn't think all teams pay that type of money and years. Certain teams are open to it, and the rest of the league isn't. Well, he wasn't, so now Trotz is gone. Way to rain on your own Stanley Cup parade there, Brian. He's Steve. He's Anthony. I'm Jay. Thanks for spending NBA Draft Night with us. We'll see you on July 5th for the On the Sports Lines' annual Midsummer Classic Edition. Remember, if you want to see this show again or catch up on any of the ones you may have missed, check us out at youtube.com/onthesportslines and check out Anthony's great piece on the Team USA being on the outside looking in at this year's World Cup at onthesportslines.blogspot.com. Good night, everybody.
Good night, everyone.